This is the great Sudoku for AngryMarks.com, coming to you here on the 2nd of August 2015 with your G1 Climax audio recap. And this was the A-Block's turn tonight. This wasn't a bad card, but the matches were kind of in a bad order, but we'll get to that later, because first, we're going to tackle the preliminary matches, the tag matches and the multiple man tag matches. Match number one of the evening had Mascara Dorada, David Finlay, and Tomoaki Hanma taking on Satoshi Kojima, Kushida, and Ryosuke Taguchi. And this one saw Kushida tap Finlay out with a hammerlock. Surprise, surprise. That's kind of how Kushida's push has been lately. I kind of expected the match because it involved Kushida to end exactly in this fashion. And David Finlay is kind of the man of the three that would do the job on his team. So that was, I saw that one coming, and oh, surprise, surprise, after the match. Guess what? Satoshi Kojima attacks Tomoaki Hanma. Guess what? Tomoaki Hanma is Satoshi Kojima's next opponent in singles competition. I really thought we were past this gimmick here, Kojima, but apparently not. So yeah, match number one goes to Satoshi Kojima, Kushida, and Ryosuke Taguchi. Moving on to the second match, we had a regular tag match, Bullet Club. Cody Hall and Yujiro Takahashi faced off against Michael Elgin and Jay White. And while Takahashi won the match with a twisting variation of the Dominator, the offense in this match was all Elgin and White, and mostly Elgin. At the beginning of the match, I was wondering who the fans were going to chant for, and Elgin kind of put that to rest for me, where he did the slingshot dropkick between the ropes, out of the ring, nailed Takahashi with it, and starts slamming the ring apron with his hand, getting the fans to clap and cheer him on. So it was good to see him kind of pump up the fans and get them on his side, and it really says something when a guy from Canada can pump up a Japanese crowd to cheer over a Japanese local, even when that Japanese local is a heel for Bullet Club. It just speaks volumes about Michael Elgin there. And yeah, from the Michael Elgin spot, I'm just going to start doing a Michael Elgin power spot of the card, because he had one. He has one every time New Japan runs the G1 Climax and he's in it. Every card he has a spot that just shows off his power. The one in this match was from a roll-up position. Michael Elgin squat lift power bombed Cody Hall. Holy fucking shit, was that a hard way to power bomb Cody Hall. The offense, as I said, was mostly Elgin, but Takahashi did end up getting the pinfall victory for Bullet Club in match number two. Match number three was a six-man tag. We had the Chaos, I called them the Chaos A2 team of Tomohiro Ishii, Shinsuke Nakamura, and Yoshihashi, taking on Captain New Japan, Yuji Nagata, and Haruki Goto. And, yeah, this one, Chaos A2 team wins with the Yoshihashi Swanton Bomb that he's been doing lately. But I guess the big story in this match was, again, Shinsuke Nakamura. And at the beginning of the match, Nakamura signaled to both Yoshihashi and Ishii that he wanted to start off the match. And oohs and ahs just echoed from the crowd. And Nakamura is really doing a good job of no-selling a legit injury. He did look human in this match. He didn't wrestle any more than he had to, but he did wrestle smart, and he did still get in his Shinsuke Nakamura spots. So Chaos does go over in match number three, and Nakamura, while looking human, did not look all that much injured. Match number four of the night, we had Bullet Club again, this time Tomoki Tonga and Carl Anderson taking on the A2 team for Chaos of Kazuchika Okada and Gato. And, yeah, Tonga hit his finisher, the head shrinker, which is a double underhook jumping DDT on Gato to pick up the win for Bullet Club. The only really thing of note in this match that got my attention was when Okada tagged Gato into the match, Gato got an even bigger pop from the crowd than Okada did, and it was just kind of like being in Bizarro World. I'm like, what kind of world am I living in where Gato gets a bigger pop than Okada? But he did, but unfortunately for him and for his partner, Okada, it was Tama Tonga and Carl Anderson who went over in match number four. Match number five was the first G1 Climax Block A match of the night. We had Kota Ibushi taking on Hiroyoshi Tenzin, and this was a fantastic match. This I would have had as the co-main event of the night. I would have put this as match number 8 out of 9. Ibushi won this match in a wonderful fashion. He just leveled Tenzin with a roundhouse kick, a high roundhouse kick to the head as Tenzin was rebounding off the ropes. Ibushi climbs up to the top turnbuckle, comes up with a beautiful Phoenix Splash, and gets the 1-2-3 count fall victory. And for some reason, Hiroshi Tenzin had these red circles on his back for the match. I mean, I'm guessing he went for acupuncture and they did cupping or something. But, yeah, it was weird to see these round red circles that look like welts on Tenzin's back. I'm like, what are those from? And the other memorable spot of this match was where Ibushi tried to counter Tenzin's moves by mirroring him. And by mirroring him, he was hitting Tenzin with standing headbutts with the double Mongolian chops. It was really interesting to see Ibushi mirroring Tenzin's moves, but Tenzin got fed up after a while, and when Ibushi was coming off the ropes, he nailed him with a mountain bomb, another signature move from Hiroshi Tenzin there, but it was Kota Ibushi who picks up the win in your first G1 Climax A-Block match of the night. Second G1 Climax A-Block match was Katsuyori Shibata versus Bad Luck Fale. And, yeah, the less I say about this match, the better, as Shibata wins the match with that stupid-ass penalty kick to the head. I didn't like it when Randy Orton does it, and I don't like it when Katsuyori Shibata does it. He's got much better moves in his arsenal, and a kick to a seated opponent is just pretty stupid. In fact, this kick didn't even connect to Fale's head. It caught him in, like, the chest. It's just lame. Every time I see this finisher, I become less and less a fan of Katsuyori Shibata. So he goes over Bad Luck Fale in the second G1 Climax A-Block match. Now, match number 7, this I would have put as the main event of the card. I would have put this in last at number 9. We have AJ Styles versus Doc Gallows. We have the former IWGP Heavyweight Champion AJ Styles taking on the big man of the Bullet Club, Doc Gallows. And I'm always interested to see Bullet Club on Bullet Club matches, and I was especially interested to see who the fans would be behind in this match. And the fans definitely got into this match. Right as the match started, AJ Styles and Gallows did a two sweet high five, and the fans applauded the show of good sportsmanship. And again, I must be in Bizarro World, because we have New Japan Pro Wrestling fans applauding members of Bullet Club for good sportsmanship. Who would have thunk it? And it didn't take long to figure out who the fans were getting behind in this match. Early on in the match, they were solidly behind Styles. At one point, they did a chant of AJ Styles. And that was pretty cool to see, doing like an American-style chant for AJ Styles. And AJ Styles does get the victory here, and it was phenomenal, as the moniker for AJ Styles goes. This was a fitting finish for a Bullet Club on Bullet Club match. Styles hooked one of Doc's arms, hoisted him up, and as I was typing, I was like, could it be? Is it? Holy fuck, yes it is. Styles hoists Gallows up and plants him into the match with Prince Devitt's own Bloody Sunday and picks up the 1-2-3. This is how a Bullet Club on Bullet Club match should have gone, and that is the way it went. This should have been your main event for the night, but unfortunately there are two matches after this, and it all goes downhill from here. Match number 8 saw Togi Makabe versus Tetsuya Naito, and I really, really hate seeing Naito in the main event. I'll try to be brief with why I didn't like this. Naito once again comes out in his suit and a skull gimmick, takes about 6 years to disrobe. Red Shoes finally rings the bell with Naito having just taken his mask off but still having the suit on. And yeah, it just gets really old really quick, especially when you're in a co-main event, and oh, it's just infuriating. But, yeah, what I did like seeing in this match was that Tetsuya Naito's head got busted wide open. And I'm wondering to myself if this was a hard way busted open Naito forehead or if he bladed. If he bladed, he would have had to have done it before he got dragged up to the top turnbuckle and had his head wrung off that metal ring post, not once, but twice by Makabe, or Makabe may have had a blade and sliced him, because after the match, it did look like Naito's head was cut with a blade, but I sure didn't see it. Whoever bladed him, if it was a blade, was very stealth about it, but holy fuck with the finisher on this one. Makabe spider suplexes Naito from the top turnbuckle to the mat after that top rope head bashing on the ring post that cut Naito open. Spider suplex to the mat. And then Makabe comes off that top turnbuckle with the King Kong knee drop and gets the pinfall victory over a battered and bloody Tetsuya Naito. I really enjoy seeing Tetsuya Naito battered and bloody and losing. So the less I have to say about this match, the better. We'll just say that Makabe won, and we'll move on to the travesty of the main event, which was Toru Yano versus Hiroshi Tanahashi. And, yeah, you know it's bad when in my review I'm typing, please, please, please let this be the setup for a finish. When I want the match to end, that's not what I pay my 999 yen a month for in New Japan World. And I really didn't like this match because it had a very WWE feel to it. And, again, that's not why I pay my 999 yen a month. And there were just all kinds of things that I didn't like in this match. There was a point in this match where Tanahashi should have won by countout. The two of them were battling outside of the ring. Tanahashi hops up under the ring apron at the count of 19. He kicks Yano to the ring apron. Tanahashi slides back in at 20, and at about 21, 20.9 maybe, Yano manages to come back into the ring, but there was a slow count. Even the fans were oohing and aahing like he got counted out, but, you know, it didn't happen. And I really wish the referees would count like they should count and that they would DQ, but that's a different story. There were so many times in this match when Yano could have gotten disqualified. At one point, he pushed Red Shoes into the ropes, crotching Tanahashi as he was going for a high five fly flow. I mean, come on now. This is not a comedy match. This is a main event of a G1 climax. You know, this would be fine for the first match of the evening, maybe even the first match of a G1 climax singles block, but in your main event, I don't want to see a comedy match. Also, is it like a requirement that you not ever disqualify anyone in a G1 climax if you're a referee? Do they fire you instantly? But yeah, I mean, again, you know, there was chairs brought in into the ring, you know, Red Shoes takes a ref bump, and I'm like, oh my goodness, another ref bump. If I had wanted to see a ref bump, I would have paid $10 a month to get the WWE Network in a main event. I don't want to see it in New Japan. And yeah, as Tanahashi DDTs and then sling blades Yano on this chair that Yano introduced into the ring in the first place, Tanahashi goes to slide the chair out of the ring so the referee won't see it, and what happens? The chair actually hits Red Shoes on the way out of the ring. And does Red Shoes disqualify them? No. I'm firmly of the impression that you could bring a handgun into a ring at a G1 climax match, shoot your opponent dead in the chest, and you wouldn't be disqualified. You might get arrested and thrown in jail for murder, but the referee certainly wouldn't disqualify you for shooting somebody. But yeah, thankfully, Hiroshi Tanahashi does go over in the way you would expect with a high fly flow. He gets the victory over Toru Yano, and this is just shit. You should not have Yano in a main event, nor should you have Naito in a main event or a co-main event. Had they flipped the script and put these two matches first and had the Styles versus Doc Gallows match as your main event with Shibata and Bad Luck Fale, or with even Kota Ibushi and Hiroyoshi Tenzin as the co-main event, either of those would have been a better co-main event, and definitely Styles and Gallows should have been your main event. But it is what it is, and the A block just can't hold a candle to anything that the B block does in their singles matches. And that about will wrap it up here for my G1 Climax for August the 2nd. This is The Great Sudoku for AngryMarks.com. With your feedback, with your comments and suggestions, get at me on Twitter, @GreatSudoku.